Hello, and welcome to Family Matters, a joint production of the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and the University of the District of Columbia. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt from the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family and your host for Family Matters. Each of us comes from some version of a family, and all of us struggle with many of the same issues and the same struggle for good relationships. It's our purpose to provide ideas that can be useful in thinking about your relationships and the families in which you are a part. Throughout this series of television programs, you will hear from people who've had experience in helping families with a variety of issues. My guests will address such subjects as surviving teenage children, marital conflict, obesity, violence in the family, and other subjects. Again, I'm delighted to have Dr. Michael Kerr, director of the Georgetown Family Center, now known as the Bowen Center for the Study of the Family, as my guest for a second interview on the topic of family systems. Dr. Kerr grew up in Swarthmore, Pennsylvania. He graduated from the University of Notre Dame and from Georgetown University Medical School. He assumed leadership of the Bowen Center in 1990 upon the death of its founder, Dr. Murray Bowen. In addition to multiple publications, he's the author of Family Evaluation, a text published by Norton that is used in many family training programs in the United States. Dr. Kerr just completed One Family Story, which began on our website but is a primer on Bowen Theory and available in publication. He's also the editor of Family Systems, a peer-reviewed journal about the family, sponsored by the Family Center. Welcome again, Dr. Kerr.
Thank you.
I think I'm going to change gears a little bit today and ask you about thinking about people who come to the Family Center. And once a person is interested in learning more about their families and how their families operate and are interested in doing something that would affect change in the system, and they come through the door of the Family Center, what could they expect? In other words, what happens once a person gets involved with trying to think differently about their families?
I think one of the difficulties in talking about family systems theory is that it often sounds very interesting to people. It makes sense. The idea is attractive. And inevitably the question comes, well, how do you apply this? How do you make this useful in your own life? And when we talked the first time, I think probably, you know, I conveyed the importance that it had in my own personal life as part of the reason that I was attracted to these ideas in the first place. Really, where does it begin? In general, I would say that life being what it is, everybody has problems. I've never liked the term dysfunctional family, for example. It implies there are normal families and dysfunctional families. And I think families are more alike than they're different. None of us are supremely emotionally mature. We all run into difficulties. So I think that the step toward getting some help really begins with that attitude that it's not odd or not strange or there's not something wrong with my family because I need to get help. I think more importantly, well, Dr. Bowen, you may remember, had a phrase, it's how you play the hand you're dealt. I mean, nobody has any control over the hand you're dealt, but we do have some control over how we play it. And I think every family at some point runs into significant problems and tries their darndest to do something about it, but often wind up spinning their wheels. I was thinking in preparing for this of a family I saw a couple of years ago, I think who was quite fortunate from my perspective, in the sense that she had a daughter who was under 10 and having lots of difficulties and lots of tensions in the house surrounding that daughter. And she was thinking, I need to get this daughter to a child psychiatrist for therapy. And she talked to a friend or two, and it turned out one of her friends had been at the family center and said, you know, maybe before you do that, it might be worthwhile to think about, maybe this is a family thing. And if you can think about it as a family thing, it might turn out to be more productive instead of trying just to take your daughter to somebody. And, you know, there's a lot of knowledge available about families. So she called the center and came in already receptive to the idea that maybe this wasn't just about her daughter. In that case, her husband didn't particularly want to come.
And well, that raises interesting questions about who should come, or who and how many can come to be effective. I know there are schools of thought that unless everybody comes, they won't even have the appointment. I don't know whether that's even still being done or not, but I know there was an era where that was being done. So from your standpoint, what constitutes effectiveness?
I think the person, two ways it happens. Usually in most family situations, somebody winds up more uncomfortable than the others for one reason or another. And they have a motivation based on that. And they may be stuck thinking they've got to get somebody else to come in with them if anything's going to happen. A common example of that would be, let's say, a wife who's got a heavily drinking husband, and she has been at him and at him about that, wants him to go to AA, wants him to quit drinking, you name it, and he fights her, and there's a lot of tension about it, and she's sort of thinking, how can I ever get help for my husband? And how freeing it is just for that wife to think, well, maybe I could go and look at myself here. Of course, this is what Al-Anon has tried to do for a long time too, trying to involve other family members. But that's the decision that anybody can become the leader, although usually it's going to be one of the two parents.
And well, you're adding a new dimension to this, and the thing I think is interesting is that a wife who has a husband who is drinking can be seen as a victim, and yet you are describing looking for someone who could be a leader in the system. And I think that is a very different departure.
Yeah, and with alcohol, I mean, that wasn't necessarily going to focus on that, but some years ago, some people from the Boston Council on Alcoholism came to the center. It followed the publication of this book, Family Evaluation, and then the Atlantic Monthly picked up and excerpted the book, and the people there read it. And their message was, AA and Al-Anon can solve the alcohol problem, but it doesn't necessarily solve the family problem. That people can wind up with a version of the same old problem, but now there's no drinking. But for example, there's still, let's say, a lot of emotional distance or tension in the marriage. So at that point, yeah, how does somebody say, you know, maybe I've got a part here that I need to understand, and I can go.
What you're describing sounds like it goes one step farther than what the, if you're talking about, you can get the drinking to stop, but the patterns are still underneath, so that this gets at the patterns.
Right.
Is that an accurate portrayal
right.
of it?
One family, the husband can do this just as well as the wife, but the wife used to say, why do you prefer drinking than relating to me? So he went to AA, and it got to be, why do you prefer AA meetings to relating to me? I mean, that's simplistic, but these are two human beings that are having a hard time dealing with each other. In any event, one person can come in, husband and wife can come in. If they're calling about a teenager, my typical way of doing it is asking both parents to come. And initially, and I tell them, I'd like to go over the situation with you first. You're the heads of the family. Let me get some perspective on what this problem is like from your vantage point. And then often I'll then see the teenager, which I like to do. The teenager comes in expecting that I'm going to be siding with the parents. They're used to that.
Mm-hmm.
And they're kind of relieved. I had one family, the teenager left my office and the parents were driving home with him in the car, and he said, "See, I told you, Dr. Kerr told me it's really your problem, not mine." Of course, that's gone the other way. I mean, that's,
he's using you there, isn't he?
Or as one family said, I said, I got up to the board, I use a blackboard, and I tried a diagram, and I say, you know, if you can look at this, is father, mother, teenager, one-third, one-third, one-third. Everybody's got a problem here. And the father got up and said, "You're close." But then he put one-sixth next to him, one-sixth next to his wife, two-thirds for the kid. I mean, people can accept that they're kind of part of the problem. They've gotten pretty reactive and tense and frustrated. That's a step, but it's another step to say, by doing something about my part here, it can really make a difference. But what I try to do is, let's say the husband and wife came, create a neutral atmosphere. I mean, it's not about judgment or criticism. Try to get each person's perspective, how they see the problem, what they've been trying to do about it. I ask them something about their own families. As you know, sometimes there's a clue there. A mother, I interviewed a mother who had a daughter that she had worried incessantly about since she was almost a baby, who grew up with a younger sister whose mother had worried incessantly about her. And her great fear was that her daughter would turn out like her sister. Well, sometimes people don't make those links, as you know, just on their own. But when people can sort of...
At some level they do, though, or they could not tell you about it.
Right.
You know, it's kind of eerie the way that people know these connections and worry about them in the dark of night, but they don't link them up. They link them up emotionally, but they don't have an intellectual aha that goes along with it.
It's a good point, I think. It's almost a fear, you know, that the past is going to be repeated in the present,
mm-hmm.
and almost don't want to look at it. And kind of with sheer act of will, I can prevent that. As opposed to saying, if I can look at this past and understand it a little bit better, it may help me, you know, in the present. It's not something just because it was there in my family and I have a fear it's here now, doesn't mean it's not something I can do about it. I think that's one of the great things that family theory does do, is that it does provide options that people didn't realize they had. But always again, what are those options? How do you do it? And
well, to do that, you've got to get things running calm enough that you can think differently about something before you can. I've often thought this work has kind of three components to it, would be thought, feeling, and action. And most people come in with just all kinds of feelings about something. And maybe they've had a few thoughts, but then how do you think about the thoughts in a way that you can also then move into an action phase where the behavior is different? And I think that's quite a challenge, but there's a number of steps to get there.
I think one of the things that families find particularly refreshing, though, is the neutrality of the therapist. If the therapist can truly be neutral, it's not a pretend. And for me, it isn't. I mean, you and I and others who do this have put enough time in our own families to know that, you know, we had work to do ourselves, and I think that helps the therapist be more neutral in dealing with other people's families. Now, people come in and each one may be kind of hoping you're going to take their side and maybe put you a little pressure on you about it. But if it becomes clear you're not going to do that and you're really not against anybody, or, you know, blaming one person over the other, even though it may seem that way to them.
Well, it's a gift if you don't, because once you've taken a side, you definitely lose the other person, the other people in the family.
I think people really appreciate that you don't do that, and that also that you can be comfortable, because it's not easy to know or to be able to tell anybody, this is what you do about this. I used to say, everybody's an expert on the family. You tell them about a problem in your family, and they'll tell you what to do about it, as if they know,
mm-hmm.
or that you should be doing it differently than you are. But to create an atmosphere in which people can just think, like you just said, you know, we have this community course, community seminar, we call it now, on families. We've been running it for 25 years, I think, now. And I think one of the refreshing things people found out about that is they come in, they start hearing about families, and they realize our family's not different. They got problems too.
Mm-hmm.
Our families have so much in common, and that there really is a body of knowledge there that people can get a hold of. And I think you have been implying that shift in thinking, where you can begin to relax a little bit, take a step back and start trying to see again, what am I doing here, not to cause this problem, but maybe playing a part in it, and what can I then do about that? One example, a woman whose husband had an affair, and he quit having the affair, but she remained furious and couldn't lay it to rest. And he truly wished that had never happened. I'll never do it again. I had no doubt that he meant that. But that didn't solve her problem, her dilemma of how can I ever possibly get beyond this? They had been seeing another therapist up in New York, and that therapist had said, well, maybe to the wife, maybe you played a part in the affair, not implying she caused it. And she kind of accepted that, but she still didn't know what that part was.
Or what to do about it either, it would sound like. No one, when you're stuck, you don't know what to do with something.
Right. But I think what was really helpful to her is that we went back over kind of what had happened after their first child was born, the tensions in the house, her insecurities about being a mother, her husband, her whole attitude about him changed. Acknowledging she began to get a lot more critical of him, wanted to depend and lean on him more. And she just said, you know, I know, I guess I wasn't easy to live with. I can see that. It doesn't justify what he did. But honestly, I can see that I did have a part in that.
Explanatory, but not excusatory.
Right.
Yeah.
That's the beauty of systems, I think, is on the one hand, it says, you know, the emotional forces in a family are so powerful, it's pretty hard not to be affected by that. But on the other hand, you are accountable for your actions.
And precisely.
And you got to take responsibility. And I think the balance of the two is what respecting the intensity of the problem, but also accepting responsibility for trying to do something about your part in it. Anyway, I don't know how well have I explained it. I do the family history. Sometimes people don't see how that's relevant. If they don't see the relevance of it, I don't push it. I think so much of it in the beginning is just the realization they have a neutral person they can talk to about this. And maybe they have some kind of expectation. You're going to tell them what to do or you're going to solve it.
Well, that's a good issue here, is about telling others what to do, because I think that is a commonly understood that, well, people will say, I don't need anybody to tell me what to do. We can work this out on our own. As if that is the nature of what happens. And I think, generally speaking, when these things go well, it enables the person to know what it is that they need to do for themselves. And they're better able to just do it in nature.
You know, one of my first lessons in that was particularly with teenagers who were acting out quite a bit. And this was when I first started out in practice. Families would come in, and certain number of parents are way backed up. He's got to take responsibility for his own actions. We can't be hovering and trying to control him. We've tried to pull back. And other families would come in, they're micromanaging everything. You know, and the kid is complaining, I'm being overly controlled, I'm being hassled. I swear in the old days, and I'm not proud of it, but if they were pulled back, basically I was saying, maybe you need to get more involved. And if they were way involved, I'd say, maybe you need to pull back. And then it finally dawned on me, they tried them all. They pulled back, they got involved, they pulled back, they got involved.
You're just seeing a different phase of it.
Right.
Right.
And that telling people you need to be less reactive or pull back doesn't seem very helpful. And what I think can be helpful is getting a better understanding how, in fact, does this problem work? You know, and again, people can usually spell that out. You know, the husband comes home, he senses his wife's upset, his son is sulky, he doesn't like the fact that his wife's upset, he gets on the son's back, why do you keep upsetting your mother? The mother hears this, gets upset about the father being too harsh with the son. I'm only trying, you know, how this works. Mm-hmm. People can usually describe that, how this thing works, but
again, that is such an important stage, because once people can identify, this is how it operates. There's phase one, phase, this happens, and then this happens. All one person has to do is to change their part in that scenario, and it does not unfold in the same way. It's just an entire, and I think that's the magic of systems.
What I thought too is that the big obstacle there is, how do you do something without feeling you're giving in to pressure from others to change? People kind of know trying to control the other really hasn't worked, but they keep trying anyway, even though they may not fully realize it. But on the other hand, people don't want to be in the position of letting the other get their way and just going along to keep the peace.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a dilemma we all face. How do you truly be an individual in the midst of this pressure cooker?
So, Dr. Kerr, how long does this take if somebody comes in?
Somebody can make progress in 60 minutes. I by that I mean, a person came all the way from Portugal about a problem with her son at a local university. She talked for an hour in desperation of how she's been trying to help this kid, and nothing she's able to do seems to yank him out of his depression and get him to study better. I found myself thinking, I don't know what to tell this mother. She's got quite a problem here, trying to figure out how to help this son. About 55 minutes out in the hour, she sits back in the chair. She says, I think I know what I'm going to do. I said, what? She says, I'm going home. She said, I've done all I can do. I realize that. You don't have the answer to this. He's got to solve this problem. I mean, that was a one-session deal, but it did
Those
help.
Are rare. Those are really
They're rare.
Rare.
But I mean, I think there are two things that can happen. People can lose sight that they aren't thinking anymore. You know, they get so bogged down in the problem, they wind up doing things they never thought they'd ever do, going along with this and that, mm-hmm. with things they never would have, and it's usually been a gradual buildup. Just coming to realize, my gosh, what's happened to me here? I can't believe I'm going along with these things that I'm doing. I don't want to be this responsible for my son's homework. How did I ever get in this position in the first place? Of course, the school's calling me. They're telling me he's not doing well. And they're telling me I need to get more involved with him and all that. But in that sense, I think people can sometimes relatively quickly figure out they've sort of lost it and try to recover more who they are. And that can really bring a family out of the trough. But also the longer term, to really understand better
With the harder and more intractable and more intense things, it takes a lot longer.
When I wrote that book, I thought I knew family theory. And in writing some of the chapters in that book, it was one of my first insights into things I was still doing in my own life that were part of the problem. In that case, my kids were having.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, how come I never saw this before? But it gives you a lot of respect and humility for the
difficulty. Well, that's what I'm thinking about as the education model, when you have these aha moments of, oh my gracious, how can I be doing this? That is the beauty of the thing, I think. That's once you've had that, you can't go back.
Yeah, I was thinking, I guess it's almost a cliche, but we have this wonderful computer sitting on top up here. And the operator often doesn't know how to use it, right?
Or they only use a small portion of it. Yeah.
Once you click into something, and it really makes sense to you, it's amazing what people can do and how it can right the ship. But of course, every situation is more complex than another. And my job is patience, but also representing ideas and sticking with people. And gradually people can begin to trust their own thinking. I think more than anything else, it's trusting one's own thinking about something. But how do you know that you're thinking objectively? And I think that's where theory can be a big help, to kind of give you a lens for looking a little more objectively at what's going on.
Once you have a more confident self, all kinds of interesting things can happen.
Yeah, I could tell lots of personal stories on that one.
Yeah.
Little things, but you know, that's what you said. I can't improve on that. I don't know how well I've
addressed. Well, thank you for being part of the program today. You've made not one, but two contributions to the program, and it's always interesting to think about some of these ideas with you. Your experience is good, and you have good backup material to go along with it, so I appreciate your being here. Thank you again for being on Family Matters, and if you're interested in learning more about the Bowen Center for the Family, for the study of the family, you may contact the center by calling 202-965-4400 or go on the web at thebowencenter.org. I want to thank all of you for joining me in this edition of Family Matters, and I invite you to come and visit with us again. I'm Dr. Roberta Holt, and remember, your family does matter.